Thank you very much. First, thank the organizers for inviting me to Pune. I always love to come here. Okay. I will not, without much ado, with the permission of the chair, end of the day, I think we all are running quite late, so I'll just get on with the talk. Now, what, is there a pointer, please? This one? Yeah, okay, very good. So now, coming to basic physiology, what are we looking at? Patient regulates his own temperature. Temperature is low, it's cold. So thermostatic hypothalamus takes over the thermostatic mechanisms. There is a shivering, unless the patient is paralyzed, which produces heat. And there is resetting of the thermostat. Also, there is vasoconstriction in the skin vessels. So the blood is diverted to the core of the body rather than the periphery. If the temperature is high, then sweat glands are activated. You lose heat by evaporation. Again, thermostat and hypothalamus thermostatic mechanism comes into play. Skin blood vessels dilate, so you lose heat. And then the body temperature is regulated again. So this is how it works. What happens during general anesthesia? Well, the first hour is a phase one, when there is vasodilatation, lowered cold threshold to the in the hypothalamus, leading to redistribution of heat from core to periphery. So you're losing heat during the first hour. After the first hour is phase two, when core temperature decreases at a slower rate and proceeds in a linear manner, at a heat loss to the body exceeds the heat production. And third phase is stabilization phase, when equilibrium is reached between what is heat is lost and what heat is produced. Basically, what happens is 40% of your oxygen utilization is for cellular integrity, maintenance of your cellular cell walls, cell membrane, mitochondria. 60% is functional, which is CMRO2, which is for the electrophysiological integrity. Just again, going back to the college undergraduate, postgraduate days, for each degree fall in temperature, there is a 6 to 7% reduction of oxygen consumption. Hypothermia is the only modality which has been shown to have some degree of cerebral protection by reducing cerebral oxygen consumption. All the other pharmacological means, none of them have been proven to be of any benefit. That brings me to therapeutic hypothermia. Now, basically, the idea is it suppresses the metabolism, so CMR or RO2 goes down. The free radical release also goes down, so cytokine release goes down, and excitatory neurotransmitters levels also go down. So there is a favorable sort of balance between oxygen supply and demand. It decreases the release of ischemia-induced calcium, which is responsible for the reperfusion injuries, and suppresses the nitric oxide synthetase activity. What happens to the heart during hypothermia? Well, this was an experimental study, mild endovascular cooling at 34 degrees centigrade lowers myocardial temperature substantially to have cardioprotective effects, preserves microvascular flow, and maintains cardiac output. One would imagine that this you can extrapolate to human beings also. Another experimental study in left atrial temperature to 2 to 2.5 degrees, lower than normal body temperature, at the time of reperfusion. The first one was at the time of cooling. The second time is when you reperfuse. If your core temperature is lower, particularly of the organ which you are looking at, then it results in protection to that organ. What are the possible mechanisms for the protection? There is a reduced energy demand, as I already said, 6 to 7% per degree fall in temperature. ATP depletion is delayed. There are certain gene expressions which come into play. Apoptosis is reduced, and there's improved blood circulation to the microvasculature. Another study has shown moderate hypothermia to 30 degrees centigrade, maintains myocardial integrity, and cell survival. Now, coming to the guidelines, what are the recommendations? This was the STS and the SCA and the American Society of Extracorporeal Technology. These are the practice guidelines for patients being done on cardiopulmonary bypass. One of the authors is Linda Shore Lesserson. She is here. She is the president of SCA. What are the temperature measurements? Now, this is a Canadian study. Where do you measure the temperature? Okay, this is again a variable, this thing. So people measure the pulmonary artery. If you've got a PA catheter, you measure the PA temperature. Jugular bulb temperature is more reflective of cerebral temperature. Tympanic and nasopharyngeal are core temperatures. Bladder temperature, you get catheters with temperature monitoring. Esophageal temperature, rectal temperature, inlet and outlet on the oxygenated temperatures. So this was a Canadian study in which they found that 84% of the centers in Canada measured nasopharyngeal temperature, 75% also oxygenator inlet and outlet, 41% bladder temperature, and 28% rectal temperature. Mind you, one has to keep into mind the cost implications also, because bladder temperature monitoring is quite expensive. So, what are the best temperature monitoring sites? As I said, jugular bulb is for cerebral perfusion, and PA catheters are reasonably all right if you've got a PA catheter. Again, coming to the recommendation guidelines, what are the guidelines for optimal site? Class 1, level C, the strong recommendation, level C means the evidence is not that great. Oxygenated arterial outlet blood temperature to be used as a surrogate for cerebral temperature. Then again, class 1, level C, to accurately monitor cerebral perfusate temperature during rewarming, it should be assumed that arterial outlet blood temperature underestimates the cerebral perfusion temperature. Okay? That means cerebral perfusion temperature is going to be a bit higher than what actually you are measuring. And PA catheter or nasopharyngeal temperature is reasonable while weaning. This is a little weaker recommendation, 2A, level C. Now, why do you avoid hyperthermia? Stroke literature has shown hyperthermia significantly not only affects the morbidity and mortality, but also quality of life long term after a stroke. Neurotransmitters are released, blood-brain barrier is damaged because of that, cerebral vasodilatation, intracranial pressure increases secondary to that, free radicals are released, so scavenging is impaired, and the structure of the cells is significantly damaged and impaired. So 4 to 6 months neurocognitive dysfunction is much higher, renal injury is more because of hypothermia, and obviously sepsis also increases. So the recommendation primarily is to avoid hyperthermia. So limit arterial outlet blood temperature to less than 37 degrees to avoid cerebral hyperthermia. This is a strong recommendation. Don't warm the patient very fast or very much so. Peak cooling temperature gradient and cooling rate. So temperature gradient between arterial outlet and venous inflow should not exceed 10 degrees. So 10 degrees differential should be maintained to avoid, again, embolization. This is class 1, level C. Again, temperature gradient, peak warming temperature gradient. So temperature gradient between arterial outlet and venous inflow on the oxygenator, not to exceed 10 degrees centigrade, to again outgassing when warm blood is returned to the patient. Again, strong recommendation. Gradual rewarming is recommended. To avoid jugular bulb oxygen desaturation, maintain a balance between cerebral metabolic rate and cerebral blood flow. Because mind you, during rewarming, the cerebral autoregulation also may be affected. Rewarming rate, generally they say, not more than 0.5 degrees centigrade per minute. This is a class 2 level B recommendation. Always maintain a gradient less than 4 degrees. Rewarming when arterial blood outlet temperature is less than 30 degrees. To achieve the desired temperature from separation from coming off bypass, reasonable to maintain a maximum gradient of 10 degrees again between arterial and venous outlets. Class 2A, level C. Optimal temperature from weaning from CPB? Well, anything between 32 to 37 degrees. So, this is a study in which they compared 34 degrees with 36 degrees, and there was no significant difference. In fact, the neurocognitive dysfunction later on was better preserved in 34 degrees. So nowadays, actually, you do not warm the patient to 37 degrees. So weaning from bypass, any optimal temperature, even though hypothermic separation from CPB is advised to protect cerebral metabolism, owing to inconsistent published evidence, there is no specific recommendation for an optimal temperature of weaning from bypass. But nowadays, again, anything over 34 degrees is fine. Don't warm the patient too much. Coming to targeted temperature management, earlier it was called therapeutic hypothermia. Now the terminology is changed to TTM. So these are again published in AHA. Three questions which were to be addressed. Should mild induced hypothermia or some form of TTM be used in comatose post-cardiac arrest patients? Second was, if used, what is the ideal timing? For how long do you do it? And how fast should you be doing it? And if used, how long? Is 24 hours, 48 hours? Because some studies have 24, some for 48 hours. This is what the main issue was, pre-hospital cooling. The patient had a cardiac arrest outside. It is not asystole, it is a shockable rhythm. So it is important, shockable rhythm, out of hospital, cardiac arrest, return of spontaneous circulation, and patient is not conscious. That's an ideal indication for TTM, cool the temperature. In hospital setting, again, there is a debate. It's a shockable rhythm recommendation, is a weaker recommendation. If it's non-shockable rhythm, you may not do it. But again, ALS Advanced Life Support Task Force differentiates between shockable rhythm and non-shockable rhythm and out-of-hospital cardiac arrest and in-hospital cardiac arrest. But AHA says you should maintain, not prevent hyperthermia and maintain temperature between 34 to 36 degrees. So they do not differentiate what sort of rhythm it is. But important thing is that the patient should have return of spontaneous circulation and should not be fully conscious. Obviously, his GCS is low. That's why you want to protect the cerebral circulation. So targeted temperature management, this was AHA again, guidelines for CPR. What is new? I will not, because of time limitation constraint, I will not get into the old ones. But all comatose, that is lack of meaningful response to verbal commands, adult patients with ROSC should have TTM. Okay, that means all of them should have a TTM with a targeted temperature between 32 to 36 degrees. The emphasis is more on prevention of hyperthermia rather than too much of cooling of the patient, and this should be at least maintained for 24 hours. The choice is yours, whether you want to do it for 24 or 48 hours, but at least for 24 hours. So whether it should continue after 24 hours, 2015 guidelines, you may not continue with TTM, but at least the recommendation is avoid hyperthermia. Because even if during the recovery phase, hyperthermia is significantly detrimental to adequate cerebral recovery and adequate good quality of life after it has happened. What are the different methods which we use for warming or cooling the patient? Well, Bear Hugger is a forced air warming, which most of us are using. It is easy to carry. You can carry it in your ambulance also. Blanket roll is a traditional hypothermia blanket which the surgeons used to use you put it under the patient when you do surgery on CPB. And these are different types of blood warmers which also should be used. Particularly, as I would mention, in OPCAP patients tend to get hypothermic. So if you want to extubate them earlier, it is important to maintain the temperature. Arctic Sun is another temperature management system where you put gel pads on the patients. This is what it looks like. We use it quite often. You put the gel pads and you leave the patient with this for 24 to 48 hours. It cools much more effectively than the other methods. Endovascular cooling, again, it's not really being practiced in India. The cost is too much and the benefit is, again, questionable. It is effective, but again, you have to look at the cost-benefit ratio. What happens if you cool the patient too much? Well, obviously, we all know coagulopathy is one of the things which can go wrong. Platelet function is impaired when the patient is hypothermic. Novo 7 is also not going to work if the patient is cold. It impairs clot formation, and even wound healing is impaired and sepsis rates increase. So hypothermia, what matters is timing and duration with proper monitoring at a proper site. The selected temperature may be determined by clinician preference or clinical factors, and targeted temperature management is the mantra. I thank you for your attention.